I've got a special request for you. Each one of you have gone through the quantum preaching course and all the things that Bill Vandenbosch has taught. And I have a friend, his name is Bruce Brodowski. And he's going to join me in just a few minutes on a Zoom call. You see, after the course, we've been corresponding over the last couple of years. And we actually met for the first time in a reunion last year in Florida. Bruce lives in Charlotte and I live in Rochester, New York. And he's confided in me just recently that he's having real trouble. He just can't seem to memorize all the scripture that he needs when he makes a presentation and he preaches, just like Bill Vandenbosch can just rhyme it all off. And so I've just asked him to join me for a little Zoom meeting, which you're going to see in just a second. And I said, at the end of that thing, you're not going to be worrying about it anymore. You see, he's so worried about it, he's writing the entire script out, hoping to memorize it so he can say it all properly. If you remember, Bill had told us in the lessons not to study scripture to preach, but to study it to learn. And he also told us not to make any long notes or anything of that nature to preach. He basically said, just keep some real small notes. Here's my notes for the meeting with Bruce in just a couple of minutes. And so I'd like you to listen. And I've told Bruce when we're finished, he won't have any notes. He won't have anything to go by. He's just going to have me in front of him, talking to him, asking questions. And you're going to hear him. And I am sure what his heart is going to come out in the preaching. And I want you to be able to tell him after the fact, after we're done, what his preaching is like. I think that'll be a big help to him, because he just feels he can't really preach. He can't really say the word. He's a massive, a fantastic author. He's written books. He's been in plays. He's done all kinds of things on stage in the past, but he just says he can't memorize your preaching. So help us out, would you? When we're done, send a message to Bruce. Thanks. Here comes my meeting with Bruce right now. Bye. First of all, I want to remind you of this book.
Yeah.
You gave me that book a year ago in Florida.
Yeah.
Yeah. Healing Childhood Emotional Wounds in Adults, A Journey to God's Love. Bruce, when I read that book, I found out that's not your first book.
No.
You wrote a book about your dad that you never knew. He died in the war and you never met him.
Oh, I knew that he died.
So,
yeah,
she said to me, months
she says, "So you're really angry at Germans, right?" I says, "No," I said, "It's sad." I said, "Did you have a daddy that played with you, and told you how much he loves you?" And she says, "Yeah." I said, "I didn't have that. He didn't come home. I never experienced it." And so we took a walk, and we walked one block from the Historical Society. And then we took a right turn and we walked two blocks up the road and we stopped, and the guy, the director of the Historical Society, said, "This is where your dad's tank was at." He says, "The reason I know is because the house that the German tank was hiding behind was my mother's house. And I heard the story while I was growing up."
Wow. Our pasts and our futures are all tied together. Bruce, can I ask you a very personal question?
Why not?
In this book that you let me read,
yes,
I read that you grew up in near Utica, New York. You didn't have a father. You had a mother. You said in this book that your vocabulary didn't even include the word love. Your mother died when you were 10 years old, and you ended up with relatives caring for you, and there was no love in your life at that particular point.
No.
And here you are telling me now about an act of love for a father that you'd never met. Can you explain that?
What act of love are you talking about?
Going over to Germany to be there where he was.
Oh, yeah.
Why would you do that to somebody you'd never met?
How do you do it? I just wanted to go to his grave and say, "Daddy, why didn't you come home?" When we got to his grave, we went back to Holland from Germany and visited his grave, I just fell down on my knees and bawled my eyes out. I just, Dad, why didn't you come home? I needed you. I needed a father.
Wow.
Hey, so I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah, it did. It really did. Changing subjects just for a moment. You grew up, you weren't much of a sports guy. I read some story about you trying to play tennis with an old 1940s tennis racket. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, that was embarrassment. Total embarrassment. A wooden racket with old strings. And so I went and joined the tennis team. That was in eighth grade, I think. And never played tennis before in my life. So they sent me on out to play tennis on in doubles. And the very first thing one of the tennis players said from the opposing team was, "Where'd you get that old beat up racket?" And I said, "It was my dad's." And so I played tennis and I played badly. And then I tried practicing and I thought, you know, if I don't get a brand new tennis racket, something modern, then I'm not going to be doing very good. And I didn't feel that my aunt and uncle would allow me to get a tennis racket. So after they gave me a T-shirt to be part of the team, I quit the team. Ended up with a tennis shirt, T-shirt. Actually, I think I gave it back. Because there was no reason for me to keep it.
So you grew up, you weren't all that great in sports.
No.
Then I read something about your love life. I mean, you had this girl, Lynn, who seemed you were in the choir or something, and she liked you, and somehow you screwed that thing up. How'd you do that?
Well, I don't know if I used her real name.
Okay. Don't use her real name then, because that wouldn't be right.
But she wasn't in choir. She was in my French class.
Well, yeah, but she knew you were in the choir, right? So you were.
Yeah, she knew I was in the choir. But anyways, she was sitting next to me, and it was like I wasn't really pursuing any girls, and suddenly she took a liking to me, and she says. She said, "Why don't you walk me home?" So I walked her home. And then she got me interested in listening to this West Side Story record. And man, I fell over, you know, that first love. That. And then, how did I screw that up? I got ticked off because her bus was late getting to school. And I would meet her at the back door. And she was walking in and says, "Why are you late?" She said, "The bus was late." I said, I don't know. I said something stupid. And she said, "I don't want to talk to you anymore." So then I went to talk to her in chemistry class that afternoon. And she said, "We're done." And I'll tell you, that hurt. That just cut so deep down into my heart that I said, I'm building up walls around my heart. I said, "I don't ever want to be hurt like this again." And I did. I built up walls to protect myself.
That's the childhood emotional wounds you spoke about in your book.
Right.
Wow.
That's one of them.
Hey, so all of these things have happened in your life in your early days. You end up going to Florida, working in Florida, then on to Houston, then back to Florida again. And you lost your work, and at some point you were basically homeless, in debt, going to live under a bridge someplace.
Yeah.
Tell me about, what was that like? How does that feel? Like, I mean, I can't imagine people living here in America experiencing that. Can you tell us what that's like?
Well, you see, when you become an alcoholic, you drink yourself down into the pit of hell. And I was a happy hour alcoholic. I always tried to make it home by 10 o'clock because I figured after 10 o'clock, the evil Satan and all his cronies come out. I was at the end. I mean, I had no job. I had no way of paying my rent. I had no place to go. Well, what do I do now? And I looked for the possibility of living on the beach. And I didn't think that was going to work out because I didn't think the police would allow me to live on Miami Beach. I looked like he hadn't had a bath in many, many weeks. And he took the bag from the guy, which was probably from McDonald's or something like that. And it was his breakfast. And he went and took it back up under the bridge. And so I thought to myself, you know what? That dude ain't going to give up his spot on that underneath that bridge. So I decided, well, that wasn't going to work. And then found out through friends that there was a Catholic conference going on, and I went to it to see what was going on, and that's where I was introduced to laying hands on people and praying over people. And
is that this charismatic renewal revival? You went to Hollywood, and that's where you met Leif Hetland, right?
No.
Okay.
No,
how did you meet Leif Hetland? Because that was a pretty pivotal
moment
in your life.
I met Leif, yeah. I met Leif at a Randy Clark conference in Virginia.
Okay.
And
He spoke to you about sperm and winning, and God is pleased with you. What was that all about?
That's his story. He doesn't use it anymore, but that's his story. He says, picture this, there's 500,000 sperm swimming upstream to one egg. And he says, they're bumping into each other and pushing each other out of the way and all that. And he said, finally, he said, one made it. And you're the winner. You're the one that made it. But he talked about Orphan Heart, and I was writing my book about Orphan Heart at the time. And
Wow. What a wonderful story.
Yeah.
Hey, and all through all of this, Bruce, if I read your book correctly, you still kind of get pulled back into the alcoholism part of your life.
Yeah.
Yeah. And but then you said you met a guy. Let me read my little note here. Rodney Hogue, I don't know him. And you said in your book that he told you forgiveness was a decision, not emotion. And that made a big difference in your life from what I could read in your book.
Yeah, I teach that now.
So tell me about the forgiveness that, because you wrote about it very eloquently in the book.
Oh, yeah? Tell me about it.
No, you wrote it. I just love the way you said it, because you talked about the fact how you couldn't really forgive yourself. And you realize that it isn't just a matter of something you feel, even when somebody wrongs you, that you're never going to lose that in your memory. But the forgiveness has to be something you give, because if you don't forgive, then it destroys your life. And you said it actually might conflict with some other people's beliefs, but I found it fascinating what you said.
If you don't forgive, it blocks any kind of emotional healing, any kind of healing from our childhood emotional wounds. It just blocks it. And so you're receiving healing through the Father's grace. So you're blocking grace without forgiveness. Forgiveness is a decision and not an emotion. And what forgiveness does is does not say that what happened to you was okay.
Right.
What forgiveness does is releases grace to the other person. And when you release that grace, you receive grace in return.
You're not saying what that other person did is right.
No.
You're acknowledging that it's wrong. But
and not only that, but emotionally, if you do not forgive, that other person still has power over you. Mentally, because mentally you're thinking all about it all the time. So forgiveness is the most important aspect of healing. Emotionally, the father of lies is always there to tell us lies about ourselves. You're not good enough. God doesn't love you. You'll never amount to anything. And so when we allow ourselves to believe those lies, that affects our behavior and our behavioral patterns and affects our identity. And so if we buy into those lies and allow ourselves to believe the lies that the enemy has been telling us, then we, then strongholds are built around those lies to protect those lies, so that the enemy can keep you believing the lies and not believing the truth, which is what Jesus is saying about you.
Boy, there's a whole lesson right there, Bruce.
Yeah, it's on my teleprompter.
Oh, no, don't tell me that. Oh, come on.
Well, I'm not reading it.
Okay, all right. Well, that's good. Hey, every time you read a book, like I'm reading this book right of yours, there's always some little thing that pops out that maybe you think didn't mean much, but there was a little paragraph you put in that book. And it was a story about when you were a volunteer prayer minister in Orlando, and you came up to a woman, and they had to write something on their card, and she put it on her lap, and you came up and read it, and the words on it was, "I want a reason to live."
Yeah.
Can you tell us that story?
She broke my heart. We were supposed to, healing prayer. This is a method that Christian Healing Ministries use. Is soaking prayer. That's the words I'm looking for. In other words, you're supposed to keep your mouth shut. Well, Bruce doesn't keep his mouth shut when he's praying over people. Are you kidding me? And so I laid hands on this girl, reached over, picked up her index card, and it said, "I want a reason to live." And I said, "Oh God, Lord, I am in so much trouble right now, so much trouble. I can't possibly just pray over this girl quietly and soak her in prayer, even though it's supposed to work. I can't do that, Lord." And so I said, "Father, help me to help this girl. Show me something. Tell me what to do." Well, this particular instance is what developed into my ministry, because now I do this. I do this a lot with people, and that is, her face was stone cold. She had no emotion whatsoever. And I leaned down and I whispered in her ear, because I wanted her to experience have an experiential encounter of the Father's love.
Right.
I knew that the only thing that's going to break this is the experiential encounter of the Father's love. And I had to have some way of her to experience that. And so I went and whispered in her ear, "Can you picture Jesus sitting next to you?" And she nodded her head yes. I said, then do it. Is he sitting next to you? And she said, she nodded her head yes. I said, now, allow Jesus to open his arms and hold you in his arms and close to his heart. Open your mind and your heart. Receive the Father's love through Jesus' heart into your heart as I pray over you. And I started praying in tongues, and suddenly her stone face broke. Tears flowed like out of her eyes, like running water. Sobs deep into her soul came out of her. And then I leaned down and I said, you now have a reason to live. You are his daughter, whom he is well pleased.
Wow.
Bruce, we've been talking for a little while. Well, we've been talking for almost 45 minutes. Tell me what all of your teleprompter told you to say during all of this time.
Oh, I'm not reading it.
I know you're not. Where's your notes? You don't have
any notes. Yeah, well, I'm having a hard time remembering all this stuff too, you know.
No, you didn't.
Yeah.
No, you didn't. You spoke it right from your heart.
Yeah.
And I just want you to know that the message is deep in your heart. Is the message that people want to hear. Not you trying to memorize some message, but just what your heart comes out with. And what you just said right now, I think, is so meaningful and so heartfelt. And it says words that are scripture based, even though you're not using the scripture for it. For God so loved the world. And there you are loving a woman who doesn't have a reason to live. You live the scriptures, Bruce. And I just, you've got to keep preaching, man. You got to keep telling this message. Forget about the teleprompter. Forget about all of it. Just tell stories from your life. The stories of things you've learned. People are going to love it.
And then the other one that Bill Vanderbush uses that I use now is that what we behold, we believe. What we believe, we become.
Yes. I just want you to know you don't need that big, long script. You need a little notes. There's my notes for our meeting today.
Yeah, well, you see, we talked for 45 minutes?
Yes.
I'm leading them to the path where I'm going to try to have them have an experiential encounter of the Father's love on the last session. I hope it does. I hope it works out.
You realize in the last 5 minutes of our talk today, just those last 5 minutes talking about that encounter you had with a woman, you just did it. you could tell that story right there. And you don't need any teleprompter to tell that story. That's from your heart. All right. Well, Bruce, it was good talking to you today.
Yeah.
Well, you know what it's like up in these parts. So
yeah, well, I saw what's coming. You got another snowstorm coming towards you.
Yeah, somebody, Shirley told me something about that.
It's coming out of that stupid Canada, you know,
those Canadians,
weather systems, you know, coming across the lake and lake effect over into Buffalo and Rochester. And
hey, I'm glad you reminded me, because I've run out of gasoline for my snowblower, and Shirley says you better get that before the next snowstorm comes. So I better go down and get some before I do anything.
Yeah.
All right, man.
All right.
It was good talking.
Good talking to you too.
All right. Bye for now.
Bye.